When I first came to LA, I lived in a hotel on the beach. I stayed there for about a year. Then I wanted my own place. Finally, I found a four-room bungalow with a deck in the back and a patch of lawn in a middle-class neighborhood of modest one-story homes. The rent was high, $1,500 a month, but I'd lived in apartments and hotel rooms all my adult life, and I was looking forward to having my own house with some real privacy. No one noisily pacing the floor above me. No music or TV blasting through the walls of adjacent rooms. No one practicing scales on the piano in the apartment below. My house would be a perfect place to write a novel. I'd received half of the publisher's advance, most of which had gone to pay the security deposit and the first and last month's rent. I was a little anxious about the money, but felt that once I submitted the completed work, I'd receive the balance due as well as royalties, and that would carry me forward. And besides, what was money for anyway? To put in a bank while you lived in miserable circumstances? So I moved in feeling hopeful, looking forward to life in my new home. The woman who lived next door was very nice. She came over and introduced herself, welcomed me to the neighborhood, and offered to help in any way she could. She was apparently separated or divorced from her husband. She had a number of cats and a German shepherd named Prince. For the first 2 months I lived there and worked on my book, the only bothersome noise was that occasionally, when the mailman dropped off letters or someone walked by in the alley behind the houses or someone else left a leaflet advertising a supermarket sale, the dog would bark furiously for about a minute. He had a loud, piercing barking style, which was a little unnerving, particularly when he was standing in the space between our houses, right under my window. Then, early one morning, I'll never forget it, his barking woke me from a deep sleep, and the barking continued all day long. After listening for a few hours, quite upset by my inability to accomplish anything, to work at all, I went next door to see what was going on. But my neighbor was not at home, which was unusual because up until then, she'd been there every day. I looked to see if there were any intruders or any strangers around, any people in the street or in the alley, but there was no one. There didn't seem to be any reason for Prince to be barking, and his barking had a different quality from his usual style. He'd bark, then whine and howl plaintively. I wondered how he could keep it up without losing his voice. I kept on thinking, he can't go on much longer because it must be a strain. Eventually, he'll get hoarse from all this barking. He'll have to quit. But it didn't happen. When my neighbor came home that evening, the dog immediately stopped barking. I didn't say anything because I figured it was just one day she'd been away, and tomorrow everything would be back to normal. But the next morning, shortly after 7 a.m., the dog began barking again. I was startled by his ferocity and felt a growing sense of rage as I realized that what had happened yesterday was going to happen again today, all day. Again, there was no one out front, no one in the alley, no reason for the dog's tirade, except that my neighbor had gone away. The dog was apparently unused to being left alone and was upset and anxious and was engaging in a kind of tantrum. When I came over to the chain link fence that adjoined our property, I tried to calm him down. I said, "Hi, Prince, how are you doing? You're really upset today because you've been left all alone. Am I right?" "Yeah, it's tough being by yourself. I know all about it. That's how I live too. You just have to get used to it, you know? You have to figure, well, I'm going to be alone today and that's the way it's going to be and there's nothing I can do about it. And you just shrug your shoulders and accept it and lie down in a nice shady spot and take a nap. You've got to roll with the punches, Prince. You know what I mean? Come on, fella, take it easy. She'll be home later and everything will be fine." And as long as I stood by the fence and talked to Prince, he wagged his tail and looked at me forlornly. But when I walked back into my house, he began barking again, loud, angry, ferocious salvos in every direction, mixed with pathetic whining and moaning and howling. And that's when I knew I had a real problem on my hands. But when my neighbor came home that evening, I still couldn't bring myself to go over and say anything about the barking. I thought, "You miserable coward, how long will you wait? You've just lost 2 days' work over this." but I decided to give it one more day, just to make sure, because I didn't want to be unfair, to overreact, to behave like a shrill, overly sensitive, and overbearing neighbor. I didn't want to upset her. I didn't want things to get ugly. Give it one more day, I said to myself, just one more day. If the barking continues tomorrow, you'll talk to her about it. And having decided on a plan, knowing if the dog continued barking the following day, I'd do something about it. I went to bed that night hoping that perhaps the 2 days of barking had been an aberration, a lapse in the peaceful and serene life that I'd just begun to grow accustomed to. But the next morning, shortly after 7, when my neighbor left the house, the dog began barking again. I felt desperate. I thought, oh my God, I spent all this money to rent this place, to move my furniture from the East Coast, and now my ability to work, my peace of mind, my very sanity are under attack. I knew that I would have to go over that evening and discuss the problem with my neighbor. But I was also aware of the fact that I'd moved into her neighborhood, that I was merely a renter while she was an owner, that I'd been there for only a few months while she'd lived there for years, that I was the outsider. Now I had the unpleasant task of having to walk over to her house, face her, and complain about her dog. So I called her that evening on the phone and asked if I could come over and talk with her for a few minutes. She said she was on her way out. Could it wait until tomorrow evening? I said, sure. And so I went through yet another day of relentless barking and accomplished nothing on my book. And by that evening, I was a wreck. My nerves jangled, feeling a shrill sense of hysteria, as if I'd been subjected to prolonged and deliberate torture. She invited me in. We made small talk for a few minutes, and then I told her I was a writer working on a difficult book. My first few months here had been wonderful. She'd made me feel welcomed in the neighborhood. Everything had been going well until this past Monday, when her dog's barking had begun. And the barking was completely unnerving, because it never stopped, and that I'd been unable to work, no less think, since it had started. I put off coming here for 3 days because I didn't want to act too quickly, because I wanted to give this thing a chance to see what would happen, to see if your dog would get used to your being away. But now that I've been through 4 continuous days of barking, I realize the situation is impossible. My peace of mind has been completely shattered. She listened, nodding, as I spoke. But when I was finished, she said firmly that she was sorry I was so affected by the dog's barking. She'd just begun a new job this week as a therapist at a clinic, which was the reason she'd been away. A therapist for victims of physical abuse or violent crime, a job which she liked very much. It was very important work. And the dog was trained to bark. It was a guard dog. It served to let anyone know that her house was protected. She was glad she had the dog. It was a matter of security. Did I realize that virtually every house in the neighborhood had been robbed, with the exception of hers, because of Prince? Why, the very house I lived in, she confided, had been robbed a few weeks before the previous tenants had moved out. So you see, I'm glad Prince barks, she said, because he discourages anyone from even thinking about breaking in. He's a deterrent to crime. But there was no one around, I said. No one out front or in the back. I checked. There was no reason for him to bark. I think he was just lonely because you were away. He was whining and howling. The dog's just upset. That's why he doesn't let up all day long. I'm sorry. I can't help you, she said. I can't do anything about this. Besides, what do you want me to do? I don't know, I said. Maybe you can take him to a trainer to quiet him down. I'm not going to do that, she said. I want him to bark. That's why my house hasn't been robbed. But what about me? I can accept a dog barking when someone approaches your property. I can accept that. But Prince barks all day without provocation because he's upset at being left alone. I'm sorry, she said. The point of his barking is to protect my house. Besides, how do you know he's not barking about something real? Maybe by the time you come out and look, whoever it is gone. Just how do you know there was no one there? Because the dog barks all day long. I think you're exaggerating. No one else has said a thing about it. Well, maybe I'm the only one home all day to hear it. This is a neighborhood, she said. We try to live together. Bill and Todd across the street have loud parties on the weekends, and we all put up with it unless it gets out of control. I can't change my lifestyle to accommodate you. Maybe you should find another place to live in. I don't know what to tell you. I walked back to my house, defeated. Now what was I going to do? Although I felt sympathy for Prince, his barking cut so deeply into my nerves, raised my blood pressure to such a degree, and caused my heart to misfire and sputter and go into such troubling spasms that I wondered if I would survive the experience. I felt viscerally under attack, under siege. So I imagined purchasing a rifle and shooting the dog. Of course, I didn't want to get caught, so I tried to figure out a way to buy a gun without registering it in my name. Was there a state in America where you could just walk into a store and buy a gun the way you might any product? If one existed, then I'd drive there, buy a gun, and drive back. Then I'd shoot the dog from the alley and ditch the rifle somewhere in the Santa Monica Mountains. But how could I make sure not to be seen? The sound of a shot would resound through the neighborhood. People would look up and out of their windows. And what if someone saw me? It was too risky. Then I thought of buying rat poison in some distant part of the city where I wouldn't be known or recognized, mixing it into ground meat and tossing it over the fence to the dog. I imagined Prince coming over, eating the meal, going into convulsions, and dying in the yard. I imagined my neighbor coming to my door the following day to accuse me of murdering her dog. "I know you did it," she'd say, her face a mask of rage. "You miserable, vicious bastard." And I'd say, "I'm sorry. I had nothing to do with it. Maybe it was someone else who was upset by the barking. Maybe it was just some sick animal hater. There are a lot of crazy people out there, homeless people who've been let out of mental hospitals. They sometimes sleep back there in the alley. Maybe one of them did it. I like Prince. He was a good dog. In fact, I felt sorry for him. He was just lonely. But of course, I didn't do anything. I could never really have killed Prince. And as the barking continued day after day, I imagined going to my neighbor's house, throwing myself down on my knees before her, tears streaming down my cheeks, and begging her, "Please, for the love of God and the spirit of compassion, do something, anything to quiet Prince down. It's like having pneumatic drills in my ears, like an insane shrieking in my head which never ends. Look, I might be high-strung, but even a normal person couldn't stand it. In fact, a normal person would have complained at the end of the first day. A normal person wouldn't have waited 3 days as I did because I didn't want to make trouble. A normal person would have come over here immediately and shot you and your damn dog, and putting the barrel of his rifle in his mouth would have blown off the back of his head. But I waited 3 and then 4 ear-splitting, nerve-wracking, unremittingly hellish days of a living nightmare to come over here and tell you how I feel, and I still feel somehow guilty about it, as if I'm in the wrong somehow, as if I have no call to be here, to say what I'm saying, as if I'm violating your space, when in fact your dog's horrific barking has been violating my space.
I must transform an injustice into an absurdity as a way of rethinking a situation. It's hard to get angry and laugh at the same time. I must add an ounce of love to everything I do. I must have a forgiving view of events and people. I must have an optimistic view of the world. I must believe that most people are doing the best that they can. Instead of blowing up when someone says something unkind, I should take a moment to rethink the situation. If I can tell myself that the person is probably having a bad day, I mean, we all have our bad days, then there's a good chance I won't get angry. I must understand that a conflict is not a win-lose situation. It's not important who wins or who's right. The goal is to solve a mutual problem through good communication. I must not expect to be treated with fairness and consideration at all times. I must take a few minutes to relax my whole body. I'll shake my shoulders, inhale and exhale deeply a few times, and clear my head of thoughts and concerns. I know what I'll do. The next time I find pressure mounting, I'll take 10 minutes and go for a brisk walk or climb some stairs. Then, when I return to the problem, I'll feel like a new person.
What is death? If I put the barrel of a gun against my forehead and pull the trigger, what will happen? Where will I go? I wonder if expressions we have come casually to use when referring to death actually reflect reality. For example, the term, bought the farm. Could it be that when I die, I will actually come into possession of a farm I've purchased with my own money? Is it possible? I bought the farm. I have acres of rolling meadows dotted with clover where sheep and cattle graze. Fields of wheat heavy with grain appear like a great amber ocean, undulating in the wind. I move into a white clapboard house with a shingled roof. The green shuttered windows have parted chintz curtains. Beside the house is a great ancient oak tree, its roots gnarled and twisted. From one of its thick old branches, hanging by a braided rope, is a rubber tire in which many a delighted child has swung up to the sky and back again. Inside my farmhouse, there's a living room with an ancient Emerson radio. The furniture has slipcovers with paisley print, and there's a hooked rug on the oak-planked floor. The fireplace mantel bears a set of family photographs, old daguerreotypes in oval cameo frames. Next to the fireplace are a pair of tongs, a set of bellows, a fire prod, and a pile of neatly split logs. On the second floor of the bedroom, there's an old four-poster bed, the cover a patchwork quilt, the pillows overstuffed with goose down. Next to the bed is a night table with an evening prayer book and a single candlestick. In the hall at the top of the stairs, there's a trap door in the ceiling. When I pull the string that dangles from it, a ladder comes down, leading me up to the musty attic, where grimy light through a single crusted window plays on ancient trunks, bales of old letters held together with faded ribbons, and a card table with three legs. And in the dining room downstairs, farmhands sit at a long trestle table, drinking cups of steaming coffee with double thick cream, eating a big country breakfast. Sunny side and scrambled eggs, crisp bacon, sizzling juicy sausages, pork chops, corned beef hash, sourdough biscuits, hush puppies and cornbread, a great bubbling warm jug of maple syrup next to a pile of pancakes browned at the edges. Fragrant thick slices of French toast sprinkled with cinnamon and sugar, bowls of oatmeal and farina topped with cream, melted butter and molasses, vials of insulin, Dilantin, and small bottles of oxygen being administered by paramedics to farm workers as they deliriously push themselves away from the table and stagger toward the door, each blood-thinning agent, anticoagulant, seizure control medication being injected by a hypodermic needle. The farmhands and red-cheeked farm girls operate the machinery, sluice out the pigsties, repair the fences, seed the corn, and milk the cows who move leisurely among the clover, gather around the salt cowlick, the lowing of their voices and the gentle tinkling of the bells around their necks heard at a great distance. Around evening time, a long, leisurely line of cows, their tails swinging, makes its way heavily toward the barn, the females to be milked, the bulls to stomp irritably in their stalls. And the barn is a huge two-story wood frame structure. There's a wooden ladder some of the rungs missing, leading up to the loft where a pitchfork can be seen embedded in one of the many wire-bound bales of alfalfa and hay. The air is fragrant. The sun shines through in shafts at oblique angles, creating warm pools of light on the floor. I can see chemical fertilizers, grow swift, maxigerm, proliferam. The pigsty nearby is a penned-in muddy area about 20 feet by 30 feet. At the end of it is a trough filled with slop, usually kitchen refuse, and corn husks. The farmhands live nearby in small, single-story dirt floor shacks with two sets of double bunk beds and an old Franklin stove. The hoedown, or hootenanny, is a celebration that takes place in the barn where one of the elders holding a jug of corn liquor in one hand calls the square dance. The farmhands wear blue overalls and checked shirts with bandanas around their necks. The girls in gingham dresses, black stockings, high button shoes, some in bonnets, others with cloth tied around their hair. They dance the Virginia reel exuberantly on the floor of the barn. And so, there I am. I've bought the farm, and it all seems so idyllic. A heavenly reward. The only problem is that I borrowed a lot of money from the bank for seed, livestock, and machinery. And now I owe thousands of dollars to the First National Trust. My monthly payments exceed my income. I'm borrowing from friends and church members. Finally, I put on a yard sale in which I sell family heirlooms to strangers, the ancient hand-carved armoire brought from the old country on the back of my grandfather, sepia-tinted Civil War portraits of long-dead ancestors, the cut crystal chandelier from the entrance hallway. And unable to make my mortgage payments, I am facing foreclosure. My entire farm is about to be razed for a new shopping mall. My family, having barricaded itself, having pushed furniture up against the doors, boarded the windows from the inside, awaits the sheriff. He arrives saying, "I'm sorry, I hate to have to be the one to do this," and hammers a writ of foreclosure on the door. I come out and stand on the front porch with a shotgun in my hands, an old double-barreled rusted-out Remington with a rotten wooden stock. I'm still wearing my long johns. The foreman, standing behind the sheriff, has a bored look. He's taken his hard hat off, and his long hair in a ponytail hangs down his back. He's got a hand on one hip, and in the other, he's holding a clipboard and looking over my shoulder, distractedly taking the dimensions of my house, and eyeing my mother, who's huddled behind me. "Look, I have my orders," the foreman says. "If you need a few minutes to get your stuff together, go right ahead. But by noon, I've got to have this thing," he gestures at my house, "out of the way. So put that gun down, because it's not going to do you any good. This is progress. Even if you want to, you can't stand in its way. No matter what you say or do, it's like shouting against the fall of night. Forget it. Give in. It'll be a nice mall. Maybe your mother would like a job. There are some sales positions open at Laura Ashley." Behind the foreman is a three-story tall bulldozer, a huge home-wrecking ball suspended from the end of a giant crane, and behind that, a set of road grading machinery, cement mixers, flatbed trucks with construction crews and hard hats, with riveting machinery and walkie-talkies. And three deputies with sledgehammers and a battering ram bash their way through my barricaded front door. Then the heavy machinery comes through and levels the house and the barn. And my entire farm is overrun in a matter of an hour and a half. And within a week, a new shopping mall has been built. A huge two-story atrium-centered gleaming marble and stainless steel structure with huge vaulted archways, waterfalls, and interior gardens, a giant clear glass dome over the top. A small jazz combo plays at one end and a string quartet at the other. A man in cutaway and tails, white tie and spats sits at a piano on the second level, near where a miniature railroad train takes children squealing and laughing around a small circuit, while shoppers ride scenic elevators that move on vertical monorails. And having been dispossessed, and having lost my farm, I find myself driving to California in a 1932 pickup truck, because I've learned that California is the land of golden opportunity, a Garden of Eden, a paradise where I can get a job picking oranges. But I am somewhat incredulous and perturbed by the fact that I thought I had bought the farm, and now I've lost the farm, and I don't know if I'm living or dead. I hate standing in a long line in the supermarket, and some jackass at the checkout counter pulls out her checkbook. Yes, her checkbook, because most of these clowns are women. And what's their problem? These people who are so selfish they're willing to hold all of us up because it's just more convenient for them. And these women who write out checks in supermarkets usually rummage through their bags for a few minutes before they can even find their checkbook. And when they do, they're rarely considerate enough to write out the name of the market and sign at the bottom of the check before the cash register brings up the total. And so while everyone waits, the cashier has to copy down their driver's license number and take down their home and work numbers, and there's some other business they have to go through until finally they walk out with their bag of groceries. And while I wait behind one of these women from hell, I sometimes feel I'm about to explode and scream, "Why don't you pay with cash, you miserable swine? Do you realize there are 5 people waiting behind you? Does it even matter to you?" Then, of course, there's the post office. Have you visited the post office lately, by any chance? Have you stood in one of those long, long lines, or taken a ticket with a number and waited the remainder of the day for your number to be called? I've seen people's hair turn gray in post offices. I've seen them grow completely bald. I've seen crow's feet form in the corners of young people's eyes, and wrinkles appear on their faces as they age while standing on interminable lines, while 2 sluggish postal clerks service the assembled crowd. Yes, these postal clerks enjoy lifetime security. They don't have to work hard to try to service customers quickly and efficiently. They can just bumble along at their pace. Sometimes you'll see one of them leave his or her window and walk into the back of the post office and maybe be gone for 5 minutes before reappearing, while the waiting crowd grows steadily in numbers. And in those situations, I imagine calling out to all the poor fools standing in line with me, "Why do you stand for this wretched service? Why do you skulk here like a flock of sheep? Why do you let them get away with this? What's the matter with you? Aren't you infuriated by this treatment, this utter contempt?" I can't even enjoy watching football games anymore. What with the new breed of gloating, self-aggrandizing athletes, the halfback who spikes the ball into the end zone, raises both his arms to the roaring crowd with supreme arrogance, the way Mussolini did from his balcony, and performs a victory dance. It's not the way players were in the old days. Oh, these new players are talented athletes, no doubt about it. But they've added unseemly, ugly elements to the sport they participate in. And these professional athletes who pout, who go into terrible angry snits when earning only a few million dollars a year, still feel they're vastly underpaid. They want even more money because their lives are so hard. It's really tough to be a star athlete, to be treated with reverence by masses of people, to have beautiful women throw themselves at you, to earn hundreds of thousands of extra dollars by endorsing products, to perform in a game that people who have to work for a living play for the sheer pleasure of it at their own expense during the weekends. And they angrily demand more money than the President of the United States, the Secretary of State, than the CEOs of most major American corporations, than Nobel laureates, great writers, poets, philosophers, scientists earn. These miserable, stinking, arrogant, muscle-bound putzes who contribute nothing to nourishing in any meaningful way the society in which they are glorified. Who cause ticket prices to soar so that you and I can't afford to go see games live anymore, who make it necessary for there to be constant commercial interruptions during the course of a contest in order to make up for their inflated salaries by encouraging you to consume every damn thing. What about these teenage dance shows? You see them on MTV and a lot of other channels, the ones where kids between the ages of 15 and 18, dressed in the most provocative outfits, girls wearing halters showing their bare midriffs, or in miniskirts and net stockings, or short shorts, or in jeans tightly sculpted around their pubises and buttocks, wearing makeup, looking like sultry, oversexed fashion whores, pump and grind and gyrate and simulate sexual intercourse with their young stud partners. For children at home to watch on TV. Yes, what a great message for America's children, a great standard of behavior to emulate. Let's all become brain-dead sex fashion dolls. Let's all be shallow, empty, stupid, ignorant, and worthless. I mean, what's the point of freedom if you don't let it debase you, if you don't let it wreak havoc with your genuine human values?
I must transform an injustice into an absurdity as a way of rethinking a situation. It's hard to get angry and laugh at the same time. I must add an ounce of love to everything I do. I must have a forgiving view of events and people. I must have an optimistic view of the world. I must believe that most people are doing the best that they can. Instead of blowing up when someone says something unkind, I should take a moment to rethink the situation. If I can tell myself that the person is probably having a bad day, I mean, we all have our bad days. Then there's a good chance I won't get angry. I must understand that a conflict is not a win-lose situation. It's not important who wins or who's right. The goal is to solve a mutual problem through good communication. I must not expect to be treated with fairness and consideration at all times. I must take a few minutes to relax my whole body. I'll shake my shoulders, inhale and exhale deeply a few times, and clear my head of thoughts and concerns. I know what I'll do. The next time I find pressure mounting, I'll take 10 minutes and go for a brisk walk or climb some stairs. Then, when I return to the problem, I'll feel like a new person.
If I don't buy the farm, then what will happen when I blow my brains out? Another expression for death is the term gone fishing. Could it be that this image, this innocent metaphor, might represent my true destiny? I've died, and I've gone fishing. I'm sitting in a rowboat. An old straw hat on my head, a bamboo fishing pole extended over a tranquil lake, 2 or 3 inches of bilge water lapping at my feet. The green paint has long since flaked and chalked off the gunwales of the boat. I've got a cheese sandwich, a six-pack of Old Milwaukee, and I'm just drifting along, half listening to the water lapping against the side of the boat in an almost womb-like rhythm. It's late afternoon, autumn. The leaves are changing. and I'm smoking a corncob pipe with fragrant tobacco wafting heavenward. I can hear the wind in the trees blowing through the branches, fanning the embers of my pipe, causing flaming motes to detach themselves from the bowl. And I watch a tiny ember, now airborne, float away and disappear in the slanting brilliance of the late afternoon sunlight. The ember, still alive, falls on the leaf of an ancient maple tree. Then I notice that the slow leak has begun to fill the boat with green algae-covered water. I haven't bailed in 6 or 8 months, and I realize the boat is sinking. A moment later, I see a thread of smoke coming from the woods. There's a burning circle spreading outward on a single leaf, and when it reaches the edges, the leaf bursts into flame and curls inward. And then another leaf catches fire, and the tip of a branch, and another branch, and a single tree, and soon the woods are engulfed in flames like a great furnace, a roaring inferno. And I'm thinking, wait a second, I've gone fishing forever. This is not what I bargained for. And the next thing that happens is that I can hear the shrieking sirens of fire engines, then the rhythmic beating of helicopters, and see them overhead spraying foam over the forest. And then I hear the sounds of earth-moving machinery as crews advance through the woods, cutting roads, knocking down trees and digging fire trenches, radios crackling with orders. And then, finally, the fire is put out. And I'm discovered, hanging onto the side of the boat, the pipe still in my mouth. And they put two and two together and realize that I am the author of this terrible conflagration. And I'm arrested for arson, removed from the water, handcuffed, put in the back of a police cruiser, and driven to the county jail where the local DA, a young woman with insufferable garlic breath, interviews me at length. She's just come out of Risotto's, an Italian restaurant across the street from the jail, and she tells me that hundreds of homes, 2 schools, and a hospital have been destroyed, and that there are many burned and dead. An entire community has been wiped out. The economy of the state has been threatened, and a number of endangered species have been rendered extinct. And a huge crowd forms outside the jail. I can hear frenzied, angry voices, and I think, but I've gone fishing. How can this be? I'm a dead person. I went fishing. I was supposed to be in repose for eternity. And then I hear some rabble-rouser making a speech, his hoarse shrieks emanating from a bullhorn. The crowd cheers as someone throws a noose over a lamppost on the corner. And the sheriff comes in. He looks nervous. He's gray, pale, trembling. He says, "We're gonna have to try to sneak you out of here tonight." And I say, "But I'm dead." And he says, "If you think you're dead now, just wait. You don't know what dead is." How many of you have walked into the bathroom of a restaurant, a movie theater, an airport, or even the place where you work, opened the stall, and found the rim of the bowl splattered with urine, or the toilet left unflushed and befouled? How many of you have stood there revolted, turned your back, and gone to another stall? Or worse yet, no other stall available, have had to clean up the mess in order to do your business? You know, as far as their emissions are concerned, some people are illiterate. They're just animals masquerading as humans. And you never know who polluted the area either. They're never there. If you did, you could call out and say, "Come back here. How dare you leave this place in this condition? What kind of a person are you? Do you do this in your own home? If you do, you're even a bigger pig than I thought you were." Sometimes I like to imagine forming a hit squad. We'd station ourselves in restrooms and grab people who left unseemly, disgusting messes. Then we'd line them up against bathroom walls, execution style. And they'd think, "Well, I'll die, but it will soon be over." But instead of death, someone would come over to them with a bucket of human waste and dump it on their heads. And then we'd all march out. We'd call ourselves the Sanitation Corps. We'd be dressed in white. We'd wear gas masks. We'd be like subway cop versions of those germ warfare and anti-radiation people, scaled down for a restroom. And how often do you go to a movie theater anywhere in America, and your feet stick to the floor, and when the lights come on at the end of the film, All you can see is litter. Giant buckets of popcorn spilled out over the chairs and the floors. Bottles, cans, candy wrappers, straws, napkins, cellophane, cardboard, little pools of soda, and wrappers from things people brought in from McDonald's and Kentucky Fried Chicken. And it's like the floor of a zoo. It's as if everybody there is an animal, after feeding time. And then, there are the people who stand outside 7-Elevens, supermarkets, and banks, and hit you up for money. What do you do about them? First, they impose on all of us a complex of emotions, anger, guilt, and fear. There's certainly something threatening and aggressive about many of these people, so that the line between begging and mugging has almost disappeared. They give you a story, something happened, they need the money, but there's an edge to their voices, an angry, disturbed edge that suggests that if you don't give them something, something bad might happen to you too. They might kill you. Yes, the world isn't safe anymore.
I must transform an injustice into an absurdity as a way of rethinking a situation. It's hard to get angry and laugh at the same time. I must add an ounce of love to everything I do. I must have a forgiving view of events and people. I must have an optimistic view of the world. I must believe that most people are doing the best that they can. Instead of blowing up when someone says something unkind, I should take a moment to rethink the situation. If I can tell myself that the person is probably having a bad day, I mean, we all have our bad days, then there's a good chance I won't get angry. I must understand that a conflict is not a win-lose situation. It's not important who wins or who's right. The goal is to solve a mutual problem through good communication. I must not expect to be treated with fairness and consideration at all times. I must take a few minutes to relax my whole body. I'll shake my shoulders, inhale and exhale deeply a few times, and clear my head of thoughts and concerns. I know what I'll do. The next time I find pressure mounting, I'll take 10 minutes and go for a brisk walk or climb some stairs. Then, when I return to the problem, I'll feel like a new person.
Placing the barrel of my revolver against my temple, I wonder what death will bring to me. Will it just be nothingness? Some people say that when you die, you go to the hotel paradise. Yes, the hotel paradise. Maybe that's the true nature of our heavenly reward. Imagine golden beaches bathed in the welcoming warmth of a tropical sun, natives kind and friendly, bubbling with good humor, always strumming their ukuleles, composing extemporaneous songs for the delight of their guests. Here, freely given is the kind, open human warmth so rare back on Earth. Late night bonfires illuminate happy-faced guests writhing and wriggling to tropical rhythms. Young and old included celebrate with food, drink, music, and camaraderie. The hotel itself is a palace of pleasure, the rooms fitted with huge four-poster beds, great rattan chests bearing fragrant soaps and powders, and lazy ceiling fans turning in perfumed air. The swimming pool, a vast white and blue expanse, is immaculately clean. Attendants with drinks, towels, books, and daily newspapers move amongst the guests. And there is a championship golf course, a replica of St. Andrews in Scotland, with a resident pro, four-time PGA champion Chubb Chippen. The grass is carefully manicured into a carpet-like expanse. The sand and water traps are architecturally perfect, designed by a team of Shinto priests who have mastered the zen of golf. The tennis courts, both clay and grass, are drawn from the idealized plans of Wimbledon and Forest Hills. They are rolled, chalked, and swept on an hourly basis. Here, the club pros, Benito Lukash and Sleepy Steinwalker, give free tennis lessons. And I can play late into the night because tennis is a 24-hour affair, the courts floodlit by sodium vapor lamps so that the sun never sets on this sporting field. And polo is available to those from Aspen, Palm Beach, Oxbridge, Kensington-on-Tyne, and Hamilton, Bermuda. I can see ponies, their tails bobbed and manes combed into spikes, bearing horsemen wearing jodhpurs, striped shirts, Rolex watches on left wrists, and Ralph Lauren roughwear footgear, swinging mallets. There's a small area where lawn chairs have been set up, next to a pavilion from which champagne, caviar, and cucumber sandwiches are dispensed. And there, women in wide-brimmed hats and men in flannel suits observe with amusement the proceedings of the day's sporting event. Eternal life at the hotel paradise is exquisite, elegant, serene. And then, one day, I go down to the swimming pool, and the water is brackish. A slick of green algae covers the surface of the pool, and there seems to be a blood spot near the diving board. I note that the golf course, which used to be immaculately maintained, is overgrown with weeds, mangled by half-track vehicle ruts. The clubhouse, fallen into disrepair, now serves fast food. The tennis courts haven't been rolled. As a matter of fact, they're being used as an industrial dump site and reek of toxic chemicals. And the dining room in the hotel looks as if it's been hit by a tornado. Tables are overturned, chairs smashed, cutlery thrown at odd angles onto the floor, food being served from troughs, ladled with huge wooden spatulas directly onto the tabletops. I see my waiter, his satin cummerbund wilted, wearing a 2 days' growth of beard, drinking from a liquor bottle. I return to my room and find that the toilet is backed up with human sewage. My socks have come back shredded. The bed has been left unmade. There are crumbs on the sheets, and room service fails to answer the phone. I step out into the hallway and find it filled with muggers, grifters, roving gangs of hoodlums smashing shop windows in the mezzanine with 35-pound chains. Boutiques have been looted, some burned out, others simply vandalized, their mannequins garishly defaced. Knifings, rapes, and beatings take place in corridors, echoing with music from ghetto blasters. The members of the hotel string quartet, who used to play in the lobby in the late afternoon, have been garroted and stapled to the wall with huge metal rivets. The harpist has been forced through the strings of his instrument and lies in slices on the floor. And the hotel security staff, not wanting to risk injury by putting themselves between guests and harm's way, flatten themselves against walls and hide behind the metal doors of the hotel security office. Some, affecting crutches and disguises, attempt to sneak off the hotel grounds. And there's also a guerrilla insurgency, raining shells on the hotel from nearby mountains. In the town, tourists are shot down in the street at random. Doctors from the International Aid Mission, religious workers, and school teachers are being abducted and gratuitously murdered, hanged upside down from trees and lampposts. And the local population that remains loyal to the government is being dragged from their homes, lined up, and summarily executed. And I'm thinking, wait a second, I'm dead. I'm at the Hotel Paradise. What's going on here? And I go to the airport to try to catch a plane off the island. But the gorillas have taken it over, so there's no way of getting a commercial flight. Then I rush down to the harbor, only to see ships bombed and sunk in their place, the harbor mined, and beyond the perimeter, men in speedboats race in crazy zigzag patterns, brandishing heavy machine guns and firing recoilless rifles into the air. There is widespread looting, murder, complete anarchy. I hide under the burnt-out wreck of a tractor trailer overturned on the highway. And I'm thinking, I'm dead. This is not what I had in mind. My island paradise has turned into a nightmare. Death is the dancing mirage at the bottom of the driveway. The irredeemable coupon. The final handshake. The least welcome visitor. The cruelest joke of all. Death can be fastidious, or sloppy, prissy, or a mess. Death can sneak up on you, or reserve its place in advance. Death is forever. A great consolation, and a consolation prize. Death is the last thing you'll ever do. Death is nothing. Tangible negativity. Immersion in emptiness. Death has no color, no sound, no substance, no mass, no hairstyle. Death is the pinhole in the space station. A hairline fracture in a rotor blade. A flat tire on a rain-swept highway. Death is the hand that reaches up out of the toilet and grabs you by your large intestine. Death makes you stop and think, makes you wonder, makes you less attractive, makes you a member of an ever-growing majority, a member of the silent majority. Death shortens the pleasure principle and sings an endless song in rounds. Death is an old pair of driving goggles lying cracked along Route 9 in Huntley, New Jersey. Death dreams of slow-motion embryonic passageways, of frustrated spermatozoa, of hot chocolate served by a bony arm. Death dreams of the unblinking eye, of the tainted goat, of a giant amusement park, Shadowland, the final place of pandemonium. Death has the face of a friendly scoutmaster, of a furiously betrayed child, of the rejected lover. Death can have the ecstatic expression of the religious zealot. Death is a foreign-born cab driver spouting a flow of incomprehensible curses and venom, leaning on his horn, stomping on his accelerator, weaving wildly through city traffic. Death is a tall, willowy woman standing under a street lamp, a cigarette dangling from her ruby lips, wearing a beret, a short dress, stiletto heels, the seam of her stocking slightly askew, smiling. And yet there's something about her eyes, a crusty yellow scum. Death can stand shrieking below your window. It can hammer at the door frame, kick at the outer guardway, and lean on your doorbell. Death asks for the check before you've finished eating, asks for payment in full, asks you to accept its terms. Death is a riddle, a conundrum, a mystery, a paradox, an enigma, a box within a box. Death is the tunnel at the end of the light. Death is a bridge, as an abridgment, a bridge meant to shorten your span.
Run! 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 You've been listening to On the Edge, written, produced, and narrated by Joe Frank. This program was produced in 1991 for the Joe Frank series Work in Progress. For more about Joe Frank and his radio programs, go to joefrank.com.